So as I'm sure you guys know, I do a lot of shopping on fragrance discounters. I mean, that's kind of what I do here. I review fragrances and, well, I have to get them somehow. So discount websites are my go-to place to purchase fragrances from. And typically the first thing you'll see when you go on these discount websites is you'll see their best sellers page. And that obviously shows all the fragrances that are sold the most. And you know, normally I just bypass that and I go and search for what I'm looking for, but I really got to looking at it the other day and you know, I kind of thought in my head like, you know what, I own basically all of these fragrances. Why not do a video on my thoughts on the 15 current best-selling men's designer fragrances? Now, again, I'm going off the best-selling fragrances on both FragranceNet and FragranceX. For the most part, they matched up, but there was some discrepancies between the two websites, so I'm just kind of combining them here. And I do want to make a couple things clear. One, I'm not sponsored by any of these websites just because I'm talking about them. This is kind of, you know, my two places that I shop at, and that's the websites that I'm basing this video on. The second thing is, this is not going to be a scientific video. Like, I don't have any connections, any insiders who are telling me, you know, the ultimate best-selling fragrances, like all the stats and everything like that. Like, this is not anything that is, you know, scientific. It's not anything overly crazy here. I'm just going off of what I see on these websites. It's probably not 100% accurate information, but it's going to give us pretty close of an idea of what the best-selling fragrances are. And obviously, we do have a lot of fragrances to get through here, and I'm not going to spend too much time on all of them. I'm just going to quickly run over them and basically give you my opinion on them and tell you if I think that they're still worth picking up even today. So let's go and jump right into this again. And these are not really going to be necessarily in any order, just kind of a mashup of what I could find on these two websites. Starting off with the first fragrance, Versace Eros. Yes, this bad boy is still a bestseller, and I think this was at the top of both of the websites when I looked, although I don't remember for sure. Again, it doesn't go in 100% order here, just the best that I could do. But of course, you guys know what Versace Eros, extremely popular scent. It's known for the fact that it's this like partying, clubbing, young smelling fragrance, all that good stuff. And yes, it is all of the above. It does have a youthful, fun, playful type of smell to it that you would expect, obviously, after hearing about it so much. And again, it is a popular scent. That's why it's in this video. Do I still think it's a scent that is worth picking up? I say, yeah. I mean, I do think it's a great fragrance. You know, again, it does get the generic tag and all that good stuff. A ton of people wear it, but you can't beat that signature Versace Eros DNA, that minty, sweet, bubblegummy type of smell you get from it. It's a classic, it's a great scent, and you know, I still do think it's worth having around in your collection. And I do want to mention here that this is only 15 of the best-selling men's fragrances. There are obviously a ton more, so if you want to see like a part two of this video where I go over like maybe 15 or even 20 more of the best-selling men's fragrances, kind of pick up where we left off, let me know, because again, I had to kind of stop this somewhere. Wanted to start off with 15 for this first video, and if there's interest, then hey, maybe I'll make another one. All right, the next fragrance we have, of course, Acqua di Gio Pour Homme. And this is like one of the best-selling men's fragrances of all time, like ever. Like, this stuff was obviously incredibly successful. This is what kicked off that wave of aquatic men's fragrances, you know, really for the most part. And ever since we've had this one, we've had quite a few new flankers released based off the scent. Do I still think Acqua di Gio Pour Homme is worth picking up in today's day and age? My opinion, no, I wouldn't buy this fragrance anymore. I would go with for Profumo 100%. Profumo is my favorite from the line. I would go with Absolute Instinct. I would even go with the new Profondo over this one, believe it or not. I mean, this stuff, it is relatively watered down. This is an older bottle here. I don't remember what year, 2005, 2006, I think. And this one even still, you know, is pretty watered down, and it doesn't have the best performance out there. So I would recommend you go with one of the new flankers. I think those are much better. This one, you know, it had its time to shine, and I don't think it's time for it anymore, but it is still a classic scent. Acqua di Gio, a bestseller back in the day, and it even still is now, apparently. Next here, we have Davidoff Cool Water. Of course, Cool Water Eau de Toilette, another men's best-selling fragrance, gets compared to Creed Green Irish Tweed. And yes, there are some similarities there, although, you know, I mean, it's kind of clear what the winner is going to be in terms of quality and all of that good stuff. But hey, nonetheless, it is still a nice scent, even though they were taking a shot at Green Irish Tweed when creating the scent. I got to give it to them. They pulled it off and they made a best-selling fragrance. It's clean, it's fresh, it's green, all of that good stuff. It smells pleasant. And I've always said that I'm not the biggest fan of this one. It just kind of, on my skin, doesn't work that well. Now, can I recommend it for you guys even nowadays? Yeah, I could recommend you guys to get this if you like it. This scent DNA is amazing. I mean, I love Green Irish Tweed. I like this one in the air. Just on my skin, it doesn't work for me. But still, it is a nice scent. It's a cheap one, $20, and it's a bestseller for a reason. Everyone seems to like it. So that's Davidoff Cool Water Eau de Toilette. I mean, hey, what else can I say? Moving up next, we have Calvin Klein Eternity Eau de Toilette. Another best-selling classic. Calvin Klein, they have a few of them on this list here for good reason. At discounters, they are going to be very cheap, just like the Davidoff. And even, you know, you can find them at your Marshalls, TJ Maxx, all of those stores, so you can get them in person as well for discounted prices. And of course, the name brand Calvin Klein, that draws a lot of people in. And Eternity is an amazing scent. It's clean, it's fresh, it's got this masculine smell to it. It's got a bit of a mature smell to it. It's like an aromatic type of scent. It has a bit of like a shaving cream type of thing going on, you know, like you get from your aromatic fougere type fragrances, although it's not to the same extent as some, you know, full-on aromatic fougeres. Beau de Jour by Tom Ford, Fougere d'Argent, YSL Rive Gauche Parôme, all of those types. It's not quite on that level, but it gets you in that same ballpark, is more wearable, is more mass-pleasing. They did come out with an EDP. I prefer the EDP, but I mean, the Eau de Toilette is still good. Now, would I recommend you buy the Eau de Toilette anymore? That's going to be personal preference for you. Like I mentioned, I'm going to be gravitating towards the EDP because it's even more aromatic. That's just how my taste goes. But, you know, you can pick whichever one you want. I still do think the DNA has some merit and does hold up even in today's standards. I mean, it's a classic scent. You really can't go wrong with this stuff, and I honestly don't think you ever will. This isn't going to get dated. Moving up next here, we have Paco Rabanne Invictus. This one really made its footprint, really made its mark in the community for good reason. I mean, it's a successful fragrance. This one is a tester bottle, hence the lettering on the front there. If you buy testers, it comes like that, obviously, so when they're in department stores, you can see the name right there on the front. Moving up next here, we have Mont Blanc Legend. Now, this is one that I actually don't own a bottle of, but I have experienced multiple times. This one, obviously, is similar to Abercrombie & Fitch Fierce. Now, which one would I recommend you to buy between the two? 100% the Mont Blanc. I mean, it's much, much cheaper, and really you're going to be getting better bang for your buck with the Mont Blanc. I actually don't get that good of performance from Abercrombie & Fitch Fierce. Now, granted, mine is a newer bottle, so that is kind of something that you would expect here, but, you know, I get about moderate performance from Mont Blanc Legend Spirit, so, you know, you're not missing out on too much there, in my opinion. Is it a DNA that I still think you should pick up, or a fragrance that I still think you should pick up? Hey, if you want to, sure. Again, this is a situation where I would choose something different. Mont Blanc Legend Spirit, that's one, again, it does have a bit of an Invictus Aqua vibe, so maybe that is kind of a cop-out, because I was just talking about me rather wearing that one before, but you get what I'm saying. I think Mont Blanc does have some better alternatives from the line, some scent DNAs that aren't quite as oversaturated yet. It's really up to you, though. It's personal preference. It's still a DNA that works, and that's going to get you compliments, so you can't necessarily go wrong with it. Next, we've got Versace Man Eau Fraiche, the blue bottle summer hit Versace Man Eau Fraiche, one of my first designer fragrances ever. This one is an incredible fragrance. I love it. I always have. I always will. It's an amazing scent. It's musky. It's citrusy. It's just refreshing. It's just pleasing. Now, do I recommend you still pick this one up? This is one that I still do think is worth buying, even in 2020. I mean, this stuff is just incredible. Yeah, again, a lot of people wear it and all that good stuff, but I don't honestly think quite as many people wear this one as what you may think. I've never smelled it on anyone else before ever, and honestly, I just don't see it talked about quite as much as some other fragrances out there and even in this list. So it is a DNA that works and always will. Versace Man Eau Fraiche. Moving up next, we have one of my personal favorite fragrance DNAs, Dolce & Gabbana The One, Eau de Toilette. Yeah, the Eau de Toilette seemed to be ranking higher than the EDP. Again, is that 100% accurate? I would say probably not. Again, I don't know fully how, you know, these bestseller rankings work on these websites. I mean, obviously the ones that get sold the most get pushed up, but, you know, that was probably when this first came out, and it's just kind of having to play catch up. The one EDP will probably surpass this one at some point, because I can't imagine too many people buying the Eau de Toilette these days. They're probably going straight for the EDP or for one of the other flankers. But hey, I'm just going off these websites. I'm going off what I saw. The one Eau de Toilette, it's an amazing scent DNA. It's this nice grapefruit, tobacco, ginger, amber, spicy, warm thing going on here. It smells incredible. You guys know all about it by now, and it 100% is one that I still recommend even in 2020. Again, not so much the Eau de Toilette. I would go for the EDP. Would I recommend you buy the Eau de Toilette, and that's what we're talking about? No, I probably wouldn't. I would go for the EDP. Moving up next, we have Dior Sauvage Eau de Toilette. Of course, you know this one was going to show up somewhere on this video, and well, here it is. It's not up as high as I was honestly expecting, which is pretty cool. That's kind of good to see. I was expecting it to be up really towards the top of the list, but you know, the price does drive this one back quite a bit. I mean, if you look at what I've gone over, you know, at the beginning of the video, for the most part, they've been pretty affordable since. This one is not affordable. Even at discounted prices, you're going to be paying a good amount for this fragrance, but it is still in here nonetheless. It is Dior Sauvage. Now, do I recommend you still purchase this one? In my opinion, yes. There are going to be the haters of it out there, and I understand. I mean, trust me, I get where you're coming from. It's talked about to death. I try not to talk about it on the channel too much anymore. I mean, you can even go back. I haven't mentioned Sauvage in any of my videos for quite a while now, for the most part. So I am trying to kind of get away from it for the sake of you guys not having to hear about it as much, because again, I do understand. But you got to realize, from a consumer standpoint outside of the community, this is everything they're looking for and more. It gets crazy compliments. It has really strong performance. It's just what people want. It's a Dior fragrance, so they can tell everyone they're rocking, you know, a Christian Dior item, and then they feel 10 times cooler. It just has a lot of appeal to it. Magnetic cap, all that good stuff. I mean, come on, that's what the people want. That's why it is so successful. And do I recommend that you pick it up? I would still say yes. Eau de Toilette or Eau de Parfum, very cool spray. You could go the Parfum if you want, something a bit more mature that kind of strays away from this DNA just a little bit and is a bit less, you know, spicy, peppery, in your face like that. You can go with the Parfum, but really, if you want the true Sauvage experience, in my opinion, you should be going with the EDT, EDP, or Very Cool Spray. Up next, we have another Paco Rabanne fragrance, and this is another one, unfortunately, I don't own a bottle of. I thought about picking it up, and I probably still will at some point, along with all the other flankers. This one's Paco Rabanne 1 Million, so obviously, I mean, I shouldn't have to explain this one to you guys. It's a sweet, warm, seductive, bubblegummy fragrance. It's a Paco Rabanne. They're kind of known for those overly loud, bubblegummy, obnoxious types of fragrances. That's just kind of what they do best. And Paco Rabanne 1 Million, I mean, hey, that's what it is. Do I recommend you still buy this one? In my personal opinion, no. I wouldn't. I mean, I'm probably going to buy it just so I can have a complete 1 Million collection at some point. But for you guys, I would go with Paco Rabanne 1 Million Privé. That is an incredible fragrance. I have a sample of it. I think I've reviewed it. I really like it. I like it more so now than I did back when I first smelled it. And that is one that I do want to get a bottle of. Probably going to put it off since we're getting into summer. That's more of a fall fragrance, but I will have that one for this fall. Try to hold me accountable to that too. If I don't have it by fall, leave a comment telling me to get it, because I do want to get it. That one's great. 1 Million Lucky got a lot of hype. Personally, that one just doesn't do it for me. I don't like it that much. If you want 1 million, I'd go 1 million Privé. Up next, we've got Montblanc Explorer. This one climbed the ranks really, really fast. I mean, there are some fragrances that I thought were going to be on the bestseller pages that aren't, or you know, that aren't quite there yet, that are older than this one. This one came out, what was it, in 2019, last year, 2018, 2019, something like that. It's pretty new, and this one really climbed up very fast. I was surprised, and I've done a review on it. I've talked about it before. I don't really like this fragrance that much. I think, you know, they made a good shot at Crete Aventus, and obviously I'm not knocking them for the fact that they're making a Creed Aventus-inspired fragrance, because, look, every company's done it at this point, so I'm not saying that, oh, they're copying Creed Aventus. That's, you know, that sucks. That's not why I don't like the fragrance. I don't like the fragrance simply because I really just don't like it that much in terms of the smell. If I want a Creed Aventus clone, I'm going to go elsewhere. There are tons of better alternatives, in my opinion. This one, you know, the opening smells nice, and I do give it that. I've talked about before, I like the opening. Dry down leaves a bit to be desired. It's literally dry smelling, like this dry woodiness with a bit of a watery type of smell. It's almost just watered down dry woods in some way or another on my skin. In my opinion, it doesn't work for me. I know it works for a lot of people, and a lot of people get upset when I say I don't like it. That's just how it goes for me. You know, I'm going to stick with the original Aventus. If I want a clone for whatever reason, I'll probably choose something else. Can I recommend you to buy this fragrance? That's going to be up to you. I'm not going to say that you shouldn't buy it just because I don't like it. It does have value. It does bring something to the table, and it's shown in the fact that it's making it in this video. If you want a Creed Aventus type of DNA, go for it. It's affordable. Get it and enjoy it. But for me, it's not something that I really like. Now, talking about something that I really, really love here, up next we have Versace Signature. This is what, the third Versace fragrance in this video so far? Yeah, 1, 2, 3. Absolutely incredible. And you know what? I've said it before. I have to give it to Versace for really owning the market in that $40 to $50 mid-range designer price. I mean, look, they've had 3 fragrances on this list so far. There may be another one coming up. They just kill it in this price range, and I got to give it to them. Versace Signature is one of those fragrances that is 100% a classic. Now, did they come up with this DNA? No, they didn't, unfortunately. You know, not that really matters all that much. This one, I believe, came out in 2008. Chanel Allure Homme Sport came out in 2004. That was, you know, the first fragrance that kind of made this DNA, and Versace did kind of take a hit off that. There are differences between the two. I've covered it before. This one's more fresh, citrusy, and bright. The Chanel, a bit more creamy and slightly sweet, and the dry down's got a bit more depth to it. I love them both. This one is making it in the list just simply for the fact that it's the more affordable one of the two. You can get a big bottle like this for like $55 or something, which is crazy value. Now, is this one that I still recommend you pick up? In my opinion, absolutely. I mean, this, again, is a DNA that is not going to go out of style. It's not going to be dated. It's not going to be anything that smells old school or anything like that. And maybe I'm biased because I like this DNA so much, but I'm trying not to be. I'm trying to look at it, you know, from a realistic standpoint here. And I really don't think you can go wrong with the scent. I mean, sure, do a lot of people wear it? Yeah, probably. But still, it's so clean, it's so fresh. It's great for spring and summertime, and really, it's great for all year round. Versace Signature, Versace Porum, whichever one you want to call it, it is a signature scent, and it does smell great. Moving up next here, we have Burberry Touch. This is a fragrance I've been seeing a lot of talk about here recently. I'm not really necessarily sure why. It seems like it just kind of flared up, and quite a few people have been mentioning it in their videos, so of course I had to get my nose on it as well. And I gotta say, honestly, I'm impressed. It smells incredible. Violet leaf is the main player in this fragrance, which really gives it this cooling, watery type of smell. It smells great. Violet leaf, in my opinion, is an underrated fragrance note. I mean, you know, a decent amount of fragrances do use it, but I wish more did. Dior Fahrenheit uses it to, you know, a very heavy extent. That violet in there smells incredible. And I think that is violet, not violet leaf. And then you got, you know, a lot of aquatics that use this note. Invictus Aqua uses it. A lot of fragrances like that. It really smells great. It is unique. And this scent smells great. Now, do I recommend you pick this one up? Absolutely. I think this is a fantastic release. It is something quite a bit out of the norm compared to a lot of other fragrances that are out there. And it is very affordable as well. Definitely worth checking out. And of course, I told you guys there is one more Versace fragrance coming. Look, I didn't rig this. I'm not making this up. Versace just kills it in this category and in the best sellers. That's just what they do. Versace Dylan Blue. Yes, this one really did climb the ranks as well. Now, granted, this one has been out for a while now. I mean, it's not old, but it's definitely not new either. But it, you know, it did make it in this list. It did make it on the bestsellers page, ranked up pretty high. I like Versace Dylan Blue quite a bit. This is a fragrance that when I first got it, I wore the crap out of it. Almost every day, I would just reach for it because it smells great and it's super easy to wear. It's just super easy to gravitate towards and spray on. And then I kind of burnt myself out on it. I didn't reach for it for quite a while, probably over a year. It just kind of sat there collecting dust. And then just recently, I've been rearranging my collection. I've been, you know, adding more stuff to it. I rediscovered the fragrance and I love it again, just as, you know, I did when I first got it. It smells great. It, of course, it is a blue fragrance like Sauvage and Aqua Atlantique, all of that good stuff. But it's a bit heavier. Kind of can compare this to Dior Sauvage and Acqua di Gio Profumo, which actually Acqua di Gio Profumo didn't quite make it on this list. I mean, it was close. Again, I had to cut the video off somewhere. If I would have went a bit past 15, it would have made it. So that'll be in the next one for sure. But anyways, Versace Dylan Blue, it's a great one. Do I still recommend you to pick it up? I say go for it. I mean, for the price you're paying for this, you get great, great performance and a really easy to wear, nice fragrance. So we're gonna be ending this video on a niche fragrance. Yes, a niche fragrance on the best sellers page of discount websites. What is it? I'm sure you guys probably have a pretty good idea. Creed Aventus. Yes, Creed Aventus worked its way up to the best sellers. I mean, again, this is to be expected because it is hyped like crazy. It's talked about all the time when it came out in 2010. So 10 years ago, this fragrance has been out, which is crazy. It doesn't smell like it's 10 years old, that's for sure. A lot of fragrances don't, I guess. A lot of these came out before that, but you get what I'm saying here. It's been out for a while, and it still just kind of does surprise me to see it that high up because of the sheer price. I mean, look, no normal person outside of the fragrance community is going to be spending, I think on discounters, these go for like close to $300. I mean, no one is going to do that except for us. So the fact that it does make it up this high on the discount websites, even though it is hyped, it does still surprise me, and that is pretty crazy to see it there. It's Creed Aventus. Do I still think it's worth picking up? Am I... hopefully unbiased opinion, yes, I think it's a DNA that just works and works and always will. It's not dated. It's never going to be dated. It smells incredibly masculine and upscale and high-end and classy. I mean, that's just kind of what it is. Again, you know, I do love the scent, and that's pretty apparent. I mean, again, this is another one where I don't include it in videos anymore just because I know you guys are tired of hearing about it. So, you know, that's kind of what I'm trying to do, because I know it is talked about a lot, so I'm trying to kind of, you know, not include it as many videos. But I mean, I do own multiple bottles of it. I do wear it quite often in the spring and summertime. In my opinion, it is still a classic scent that you should own in your collection if you like it. Again, the price is steep, but that's just what you got to do. So guys, that's going to do it for me. That was my thoughts on the 15 current best-selling men's fragrances. Now again, there's a lot that I can still go over and a lot that I probably missed. I know a lot of people are going to say, oh, what about this fragrance? What about this fragrance? Well, they just barely missed the cutoff. I had to stop somewhere. Figured 15 would be a good number to go over so the video doesn't get incredibly long. I will most likely do a follow-up to this video, and then a lot of your favorite fragrances that didn't make it in this one will probably be in that next video. So hopefully you guys enjoyed it. Hopefully this was something a little bit different and interesting to you, and maybe this can help you out if you do look at some of these fragrances and you don't own them, you're wanting to decide if you should pick them up or not. So again, all these fragrances will be linked down below in the description. You can check them out down there. That's going to do it for me, guys. I'll see you tomorrow night with another one. Take care.